Hallo, John.
Ja, morning, morning everyone.
Hi, Cheryl. Morning. Good
Morning.
evening. Are you can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Fantastic. Loud and clear.
Yeah, loud and clear. You're a bit blurry, but I mean that's because Australia is such a far way away.
The signal takes a while to get there. I mean, when I talk to you now, it's about 5 minutes later that you guys get the signal.
Yeah, no, thanks, Stephen. We're going to start. So, thank you. Just a little bit of housekeeping before we carry on is that we are recording the session. We also will provide the presentation on our website afterwards, and we send out a write-up and newsletters as you guys are aware. This is a two-part series. Today, Stephen and Scott are going to chat to us about really audit planning and making sure you're auditing in the right areas. And there will be another session in a few weeks' time on the audit execution part of the equation. It's great to have Scott and Stephen with us, just to a little bit of background. Scott and Stephen are directors of a company called GRC Ready, which is a specialized risk advisory service based in Melbourne. We've been working with, as Barnall, we've been working with Stephen and Scott for the last, I'd say 6, 7 months. We are putting GRC Ready has extensive template documents and artifacts all around risk compliance, governance, ESG, and we working with the GRC Ready. We're quite excited. We're launching a risk maturity survey via Barnall Cloud, so that'll be coming out to everyone. It is a free survey, which is great. I'm going just to do justice to Scott and Steve. I'm going to actually read a little bit about their backgrounds because I won't do justice if I try and just talk about them. Scott's worked as a partner in three professional service firms. He was a general manager for operational risk at Australia Post, and more recently, a former chief CEO and CFO for a Victorian government agency focused on integrity. Scott is the current chair of the Victorian Ombudsman Audit and Risk Management Committee. So huge, and Scott's obviously was a former Big Four partner with over 30 years of consulting and regulatory experience. Stephen has had a number of senior executive roles. Stephen's ex-South African, you can tell by the surname. Including the global head of corporate assurance of Rio Tinto, executive general manager internal audit for the Leighton Group, a partner at Ernst & Young in Sydney, general manager performance management at the Commonwealth Bank Limited, and head of operations finance, deputy CFO for Anglo American Platinum. So the guy, Stephen and Scott, we really do welcome you today, and very honored to have you presenting to us. So thank you very much. It's over to you guys. Thank you.
Over to me. Can I just check, has Scott joined us? Scotty, have you joined us? It's a public holiday today, and I'm aware Scott and his family went away this morning somewhere. If he hasn't joined us, that's perfectly fine.
I've dialed in, Stephen.
Oh, fantastic, Scotty. Thank you for that. Thanks for that introduction, Jono. I'll handle most of, well, all of this session because it's the audit planning side of it and the audit execution. Both Scott and I will then share some of our insights. What I will do is I'll share my screen if that's okay. Can you see my screen?
I can see myself. I'm going to turn my camera off. We can see your screen now.
All right.
You're on now.
All right. Sawubona, Dumeleng Basari, Dumeleng Bana, Goeiemôre almal. Good morning, everybody. I thought I'll just cover some of the official languages in South Africa. I obviously, you know, I haven't covered all of them, you know, all of the 11, but welcome everybody and thank you for the opportunity to share some of mine, Scott's learnings in internal audit. And collectively, we've got around about between 75 and 80 years of experience. The examples we'll show you today are all from actual board audit and risk committee papers and actual working papers that we used to prepare audit committee, board audit committee papers. So this is a practical session. It's not theoretical. Buzz Scott and I are practitioners. We've had, you know, top four, the big four accounting firms experience both, you know, as partners, but this is a practical session. Normally, if I take away one important idea, one action from these sessions or even a conference, so just one idea that you will apply and practice, it's worth my time. So what we'll cover today is we'll have a quick overview of the evolution of the profession. So just a look back a little bit. Then I'll share with you interviews and this, you know, that we've had with some 60 senior executives, and also one particular requirement from a board audit committee member that stuck with me for a very long time, and it basically shaped the planning of an audit, the process that we went through for audit plan. We'll look at the internal audit role, the position of risk management, risk auditing, and then risk-based audit. So the two key things, two key areas that we need to be very, very mindful auditors. And it is, and it's a theme out the whole section, the whole presentation today, is how do we know that we are doing the right audits? So how do you know really that you're focusing on the right areas in the business that adds the most value? Excuse me. And then secondly, how do we know that you are doing the audits right? So every single audit, is it performed effectively? Does it meet the objectives? And that is planned for the next session. So for this section, for this presentation, we'll focus on how do we know that we're doing the right. There's a specific process that we followed that we developed over the last, you know, years, and it works really, really well to make sure that the audits, every single audit is focused on those areas that contribute to the most value of to the business. So we'll go through six steps or five steps. The sixth one we're not going to discuss today because it is just the board audit and risk committee and management requests that you need to include in your audit plan. But we'll cover very briefly, and I'll show you actual examples of extracts of board audit committee papers and working papers. How do you align your audits to strategic objectives and the business model of the company? The second step is the risk profile mapping, and most of the audits, audit departments nowadays, you base your audit program on the risk profile, and that's where the risk, the top-down risk audit approach comes from. Basically, we considered emerging risks for that particular organization and the industry. What it looked like to consider legal and the compliance obligations for that particular organization. And then importantly, reoccurring and systemic themes or issues, and then also follow up our previous years. So if we just have a brief look at the profession. The profession basically stagnated for many years. Scott and I have had conversations with the CEO of Australian Institute of Chartered Accountants, Scotty, I think it was last week or the week before. And the CEO confirmed that their members stagnated. And what is it that they need to do in order to provide better service and more valuable insights to the members? Up until probably about 2015, the profession stagnated. And then there was a big intervention globally where internal auditors started to provide more advice, risk-based auditing, and we got much more familiar with the process in order to align our audit plan with the company's risk profile. The core skills prior to 2000 was basically financial. Almost all of the internal auditors were financially qualified, and it was compliant. Since 2000, the customer requirements and the business dynamics changed. I mean, if we think data privacy, cybersecurity, ESG, these are the things that really impact the audit plan. What does it mean for us to provide more strategic value to the company? And this is the sort of areas that we've got to make sure that our aligned to the strategies of the organization, emerging risks, systemic issues, themes, issues that are actually driving the business value of the organization. These are some of the actual feedback that we received from 60 interviews with clients of a large multinational global company. And some of the things are, at present, there's too much overlap of assurance functions, and it strained the business. And it could well be that, in a future session, we could have a look at combined assurance. What does it really mean? How do you actually put in place a combined assurance model for your organization? Scope of the services is too narrow. You guys need to look at the end-to-end risks of a particular function. Just lift your audit focus rather than just pure compliance. The auditees or the clients really didn't understand what the role and the scope is of the audit function. And very importantly, that we need to demonstrate the value. How do you show and demonstrate to your customers that internal audit is a good investment for the company and the shareholder? Defining moment in my career was when Lord Kerr asked me at one of the first board audit committees at Rio Tinto that I attended. And he said to me, "Steve, two questions, please." And in his high upper class in English accent, he said, "Look, I can't make that do that." He said, "How do we know that you and your team are doing the right audits? And then secondly, how do we know that every audit is executed properly?" And those were two simple questions. And he said to me, "Look, I don't need the answer now, but can you prepare something for us for the next board audit committee so we can actually get confidence that the audits that you present and that you put forward as an audit plan, that you follow the due process, that you're auditing those things that really matter to the organization. In essence, if we audit the wrong areas brilliantly with capable people, or if we audit the right areas poorly, we are not providing the real value that we as a profession could or should be." And these two questions have stayed with me for a long time.
Stephen, sorry to interrupt. You're breaking up a little bit. I think it's best if you turn your camera off. not because we don't want to see you, but just to save bandwidth. I think we've got a couple of cables down along our coast, so I think it's probably our side. But maybe if you could turn your camera off. Thanks.
Is that better?
That is better, yeah. Thanks, Stephen. Thanks.
All right. Well, it's not only South Africa that's got internet and, you know, intermittent, you know, issues. We've got them in Australia as well. So if we have a look at, just go back to first principles and the context, the definition of internal audit in terms of the Institute of Internal Auditors. If you have a look at the definition and, you know, your mandate and your the purpose, you know, the goal, objective, and the vision and mission of your organization, and also of the internal audit function, you will find that, and it's absolutely clear that risk is, you know, almost at the center. It is the fundamental principle that all our work is predicated on. It's in the planning of what audits should be audited next year. So it goes into your audit plan. It goes into every single audit, you know, in terms of the scope and the objectives, that the risks are being managed properly. You know, assets are being safeguarded, compliance with laws, efficient and effectiveness, and also that it actually adds value to the business. So there's no doubt about it that all of the work we do, you know, and I think everybody will agree with this, that it's based on risk, and it's the material risks to your organization. Internal audit has got 9 key performance areas, and we're not going to go into any of this other than I will show you what a maturity assessment looks like, but you will need to do at some point in time a maturity assessment. Now, the performance assessment that is done as part of the Institute of Internal Auditors requirements, it's basically, do you comply, yes or no? But you need to have some insight into how mature is, you know, the team and the structure, the processes that you have in place, the operational management, the knowledge management. But in this session, we're going to look, you know, specifically at the internal audit methodology. So do you have the right tools in order to perform the planning for next year? Do you have the right tools to perform consistently audits that deliver the results that are expected? And this session in particular will look at do you know whether you're doing the audits, the right audits? Now, Sun Tzu, the ancient Chinese strategist, said that, you know, even before the battle is won, you know, the army, the strategy and the planning and the preparation is more important than the actual execution of the battle. And the battle is won before it's being fought. Jono, can I just check is this clear?
Yes, that's clear. It's looking good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Thanks. In terms of the internal audit functions maturity, as I said, it's not the focus and topic of this session. We're only going to look at the internal audit methodology and to unpack that in terms of 2 key processes. One, the planning, and then the second one is which is a future session. It's the execution of the audits. Now, I've used this slide a number of times at board audit committee meetings, and it just explains in very simplistic terms what are the 3 key components that we typically look at, you know, when we do the planning. Historically, we mainly looked at compliance, and that could be, you know, Sarbanes-Oxley, ASX 7 and 4 requirements, for a fourth, whatever the legal requirements are that we assess. From around 2015, organizations are thinking about what is the framework, you know, that we have in place. So the control, the system design for end-to-end procurement, for managing your human capital, for sales and distribution. And we use COSO as a fundamental methodology to execute those audits. And then secondly, you know, what's the value that you add as auditors? All right, let's unpack the how do we know that we're doing the right audits? So the process, the step-by-step follow. So the first step that we do is to consider the strategy and the business model of the organization. So have a good idea of the strategic objectives and of the organization, and how do those permeate into the business model? And we'll show you what does it look like a business model in the mining industry, for in particular for Rio Tinto, that we've actually prepared. The second step is what I think most of the audit functions do anyway, is to consider the enterprise risk, the material risk profile of the organization. Then the next step is to consider the emerging risks, and then legal and compliance. I'll show you how we've actually prepared in conjunction with the company secretary of one particular large multinational company and the legal counsel a compliance model. And then what I think few internal auditors actually do, or do, if you do that, you know, they don't do it really well, because we struggled with this particular area. The mapping of reoccurring or systemic issues, and then just follow up of previous years. And from that, it's almost like a filter, a process that you go through, and it will then provide you with a high value, a very valuable internal audit plan. So this is the actual slide, and it includes the people, the person days. So this is the final output to ensure and provide the audit committee, the board audit and risk committee, with confidence that we've actually mapped and we cover the whole value chain of the organization. So you've got to make sure that you understand what the value chain, the end-to-end macro processes of your organization are, and then the supporting activities as well. And by doing this way, in this particular year, we clearly show that in prior years, no audits were done on exploration. Appraisal were specifically audited by external firm, specialist engineers, development and production. So this particular area was totally under audited. So most of the audit days were in finance. And by recutting and distributing a better balance of audit days, we actually identified issues along the value chain of the organization. As part of the process, step one, every area, you need to make sure that you understand what specifically that particular process looks like. And as part of the planning, we then identified at a high level, what's the end-to-end process? In this case, it's manage people, what the key risks are, the scope, if we have to do an audit, and the value of the business. And suffice to say that during this process, we involved the senior executives of every single area. So you will most certainly get the feeling that to do the planning, it's not a week, it's not a 2 weeks. You need to make sure that you plan it properly and you commence the planning process well in advance before the audit committee needs to see the audit plan. Once you've identified all these areas, we facilitated a workshop with key executives and board audit committee. Lord Kerr, John Kerr, was part of the process and he assisted because he asked the question. And then out those areas. In this particular case, for this year, manage people was a massive issue and a problem for Rio Tinto because of the significant growth in the mining industry during the period where there was the iron ore price hit $180 a ton. And we had massive issues in China where four of the Rio Tinto staff were arrested as well. That it was right in that particular period that managed people was the single biggest issue. The previous year, during the previous year, had material issues, procurement issues, tires, big earth-moving equipment, the consumables, and we did an end-to-end assessment of procurement. This particular review was so successful that the global head of procurement presented at the main Rio Tinto Board Audit Committee that he and his team confirmed a direct result of the audit program. They saved $152 million run rate annually. Step two is the risk profile mapping. And in your audit committee papers, I would suggest that you actually include something like this or similar to this, where you identify that the key risks to the organization are covered in your audit plan. You'll notice that health safety, there's nothing. It's a separate audit program that was put in place for health safety and also environmental risks. So we had a separate team focusing on that. But in this, what's important from a risk perspective is that in that particular year and the next 3 years, Rio went on a significant expansion drive into high-risk countries. And we were then requested and we agree that we'll look at exploration, country risk, and the currency risk of those particular countries. So those three combined actually provided the board and the senior executives with comfort that they were able to actually expand with confidence. Step three is to consider emerging risks. Now, this is an example of the audit director roundtable, which I think most of you will be familiar with, but all of the big four and large multinational consulting companies and advisory companies do a bi or an annual emerging risk survey for various industry, Ernst & Young, Deloitte, KPMG, all of those. You will need to make sure that the emerging risks for your that impact on your company is considered in your planning. Next step is you need to the impacting your organization. I'll provide the slides as well. This is the actual working sheet that we prepared in conjunction with the company secretary and the chief legal counsel, and it was refreshed on an annual basis and provided to the main board to ensure that all the key legal and compliance obligations are identified and they complied with, and that there's an independent review. So part of the input of the audit plan is to agree which of these areas are absolutely key and material that we need to provide independent assurance over. The last step is you And this is what, something that we put in place, and we mapped all of the audit findings for the past 3 years, and then we maintained the database. So if you look at an individual audit, then you'll see that there's maybe a medium, low, medium, high issue. But the moment you start combining them, and you look at and you analyze the findings, you may find that there are issues that are systemic across the organization, across your different business units, your different departments. And that then may become a specific audit on its own, because it may indicate that there's a systemic issue at a group level that nobody's actually been able to quantify and identify. So this was so powerful that we use this in order to, this is just one of many examples, and I just provided you with an extract of a working paper. But this area combined across the organization, and the SAP system was reconfigured, and the processes were redesigned as a consequence of that. So the last step number six is to make sure that management requests and the board audit committee requests are considered as well. So typically you have between 10 and 15 or 20% a buffer in your audit plan to make sure that you can accommodate management requests. But in essence, if you go through these steps, in your you may decide one, two, and three, and the rest I'm not going to do this year. But if there's one or two areas that you may want to think about carefully in your next audit planning cycle that you want to include, it will provide the confidence that your stakeholders will have confidence, your board audit members, the executive committee, that your audits are actually delivering real value and it's aligned to the organization's strategy, the business objectives, and it's a good investment. That's just a quote from, and I've got Guy Elliott's permission to share this. I've presented this exact to international conferences, but this is just to show you that if you are able to explain succinctly the process you go through in order to get to an audit plan, and it's well designed, and it focuses on those areas that really matter to the organization, your stakeholders will value that, and it will be escalated, and they will recognize your service as a good investment. I will stop there. And then I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Stephen. That was great. Thank you very much. Cheryl's going to open the floor now, and then if anyone would like to put their hand up to ask Stephen or Scott any questions. I know we can't see Scott at the moment, but thanks, Stephen. That was great. Yeah, we battled a bit with connectivity. I don't know what's going on, but... just shows how reliant we are on technology.
absolutely, Jono.
So, everyone can unmute you. Question. You are able to unmute yourself if you'd like to ask questions. Yeah. Are there any questions from anyone? Very quiet. Yeah, just from my perspective, we do see often audits that are, from our technology perspective. We see a lot of audits that are very focused on working papers, very control focused. You know, it's all about control objectives and controls. And, you know, Barnall was kind of designed with risk and control based in mind, you know, from objectives to risks to controls. And, you know, over the years, we've often found clients just jump straight into audit steps with controls, and they don't seem to identify the risks that are then linked to the more the business objectives and the strategic objectives. So it's still quite a thing all these years later that there are a lot of audits that are not risk and control based, in my opinion. Yeah.
Yeah, Jono, I mean, as I mentioned, you can brilliantly audit the wrong things, and it's of no value to the organization, or limited value. Or if you audit the right things, I mean, and it's so important that you need to make sure that your audit entity are absolutely the right things. And if it's an end-to-end, can I maybe check how many... Are there any of the participants who've actually done an end-to-end procure-to-pay or a human capital hire-to-retire capital investment lifecycle, your whole investment lifecycle audits? Or is it just, you know, if you look at procurement, procure-to-pay, accounts payable, your stores, your assessment, that sort of thing?
You broke up a bit there, Stephen, but I don't know why we've got such a quiet audience today. Is there anyone that's done these audits? Can anyone unmute themselves? I wonder if I see we've got the new Teams format. So, Mpo, you've put a comment saying yes, you have. Can anyone unmute themselves? I know it's a new team, so I wonder if that's the problem. Cheryl, can you? Is there anyone?
Yeah. So in you can unmute.
Okay. So, Tiwe, you've got your hand up.
Yes. I want to say I have been involved in the hire to retire one, and I'm actually in the middle of wrapping up another one right now. So I've been involved in that one where we look at the entire human capital investment from the time we recruit, retention, reward systems, and up to the time where we look at the exit strategies, separation, how employment is terminated. So our approach was we look at each step, more like what we're calling the value chain. We look at risk vulnerabilities, and that includes even the review of policies, processes, risk vulnerabilities, and control procedures in place. And then we execute the audits in terms of adequacy after those assessments. Where there's elements of inadequacy, then we propose or recommend a corrective action plan. Where we feel like it's adequate or risk is mitigated to acceptable levels, then we look at the effectiveness of the control procedure. So that's how we've basically done it.
Sipachiwe, is that how you pronounce your name?
It's Siphathisiwe.
Siphathisiwe. That's absolutely fantastic. You know, it is that sort of audit that, you know, once it's performed, it actually cuts across multiple divisions, multiple departments. And very often you identify material issues, coordination, handover from one department to another department. And, you know, the board actually values the insights and, you know, that sort of view from an end-to-end perspective. You know, they don't often get that from, you know, many internal audit functions. So well done. And were there any specific material findings or deficiencies that you identified?
Yes, there were. There were because the maturity levels, I think they were, I would say, premature. The function itself was at premature levels because they had just drawn the HR strategy for the first time. So now how it gets cascaded to the divisions and how it gets operationalized was a big challenge. There was no transparency or a process of linking that. So each divisional manager would do their things their way. And also you'll find that one of the challenges they are facing is, you know, legacy issues whereby the operational manager feels like I should be telling you as HR what I want you to do for me. And it's up to me whether I take your guidance or not. So whereas some of these things are critical and speak directly to the strategy, but because the person on the pedestal doesn't have a proper appreciation of what this other HR person is trying to suggest to promote strategy implementation, it then you'll find that the effectiveness of the alignment now will depend on the level of understanding in terms of the business heads and their level of cooperation and their priorities. At times they can understand it, but if they are running a tight ship whereby cost containment is a big factor, they may feel like it's a cost that we can forego. Even little things like training to say, but it's going to take us some time. We're going to have to spend a few runs on training people, change management, implementing this whole thing that you're talking about. But since in the past, how we've done things has worked, we will do it that way. So it was some of the challenges that we observed, which they were facing. And in some instances, key policies were not in place, resulting in also inconsistencies in managing human capital. And when I talk about key policies, some of them, it's fundamental ones like recruitment and termination policies, rewards, rewards policies, like maybe after 5 years, people get rewards. If the policy is not clear, you'll find that in one division, they are rewarded differently. In another division, they're rewarded differently because the policy is vague and it's subject to many interpretations. Those were some of the major issues that we found. But the most positive thing that gave us comfort is reduction of our audit risk. We were comfortable that we covered all the major risks relating to the HR space.
You see, well done. That's a sort of the audit. I mean, I, during my career, I've had so many people asking me, you know, what is the strategic value? How do we audit, you know, strategic audits? This is exactly it. You know, you contribute to the strategic direction of your organization. And human capital is such an important area that I don't understand why, you know, internal auditors often, you know, neglect the focus on human capital. And it is, you know, you've nailed it 100%. So well done.
Yeah, thank you. That's great. So very good input. To the point, and very clear, actually. Very good. Are there any other questions?
Hey
Scott. We can't hear you, Scott.
You unmute yourself.
There I am. Well done, Stephen.
Thank you. You're breaking up there, Scotty. Put your camera.
You've done such a good job. You've muted everyone.
Yes.
Are you enjoying your holiday, Scott? Anzac Day.
Very much so. Yep. No, having a good time. Thank you.
Look, I think if there are no further questions, Jono, maybe we should call it call the session. And if anybody's got specific questions, then more than happy if you provide my email and Scotty's email to them, that we'll get back to people and answer any specific questions. The slide deck will be made available to everybody, and then next time we can unpack how do you make sure that you're doing every audit consistently of high quality.
Yeah, thanks Stephen. One last, if anyone wants to put their hand up, please go for it, but otherwise we're going to call the session, as Stephen says. But thank you very much today, Stephen, for your time. And thanks, Scott. And I know you guys are, it's a public holiday there, but we really appreciate your time. We look forward to the next session. And we'll make all the slides available and the recording. So thank you very much. And thank you to our audience for joining us. I think we had 62 or 63 people online at the start. So it's a great turnout. So thank you very much. Thanks.
Very welcome. And enjoy the rest of your cold day in South Africa.
Thanks, Stephen.
Thanks, Jono.
Thanks, Scott. Cheers.
Okay, bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye-bye. Bye. Bye.